I must confess that until seeing a film recently, I'd never heard of King Redwald, the King of East Anglia, whose reign lasted from around 599 AD until his death in 624. And yet, one of the finest Anglo-Saxon treasures ever discovered in Europe was found under a mound in a Suffolk field. Could this be his? So come with me now as we arrive on a misty morning near the River Deben to a field near Woodbridge in East Anglia in the United Kingdom. The name of our destination is Sutton Hoo, which in the ancient language of the time meant Sutton, southern, and Hoo, raised ground. The largest of the mounds, which was excavated in 1939, just before the Second World War, has been made even more famous recently by the release of a motion picture named The Dig. At the start of our story is Mrs. Edith Pretty. She was the daughter of a wealthy industrialist and widow of a military colonel. She bought the splendid property called Tranmer House, together with 526 acres of land known as the Sutton Hoo Estate. Although the estate had many burial mounds within its boundaries, they were thought to have been either ransacked in antiquity or of no particular academic interest. Some of the smaller mounds have been excavated more recently in the 20th century, and human remains were found alongside that of horse skeletons. This was a common practice at the time when a great leader or somebody of importance died. Their trusty steed was dispatched and buried alongside them. None of these graves, however, boasted anything of exceptional interest. This had always been thought to have been an area set aside for royal burials, but this had never been confirmed. Neither the British Museum nationally or the local museum in Colchester were ever interested enough to fund excavations of the large mound. Mrs. Pretty had leanings towards spiritualism, and it was known locally that she'd had premonitions of ghostly warriors walking atop the largest of the mounds. So certain was she that the large mound was an important burial site, she contacted a diviner. After visiting the site, the diviner, or dowser as they were called, confirmed that readings taken by this ancient art suggested that there was indeed gold within the mound. All this prompted Mrs. Pretty to enlist the help of a local man, Mr. Basil Brown, to start excavating for her. Although not a learned scholar, he had the reputation for being a very careful and methodical worker when excavating, and they agreed a salary for him to undertake what might turn out to be quite a long task. At the beginning of his employment, however, and to Mrs. Pretty's annoyance, he preferred to begin working on one of the smaller mounds, as the larger one showed signs, he thought, that it had already been plundered in the distant past. The first trial trench of his favoured mound proved worthless, so he was persuaded again by Mrs. Pretty to have a trial trench dug on the large one. What was to unfold confounded all previous knowledge of Anglo-Saxon artefacts when not only the longship was exposed, but also the treasure was eventually found. It wasn't long before the first trench gave up the remains of some metal rivets. This intrigued Mr. Brown at first, and after more excavation, the impression of a boat started to emerge. The River Deben, after all, was in the vicinity, but why haul a small boat all that way and bury it? After further work, it began to dawn that this was no small boat, but a longship. Parallels were then drawn with the stories of Beowulf and the style of the ship, in which it was estimated it would take about 40 oarsmen to propel. Certainly it lent some credence to the thought. The fact that it had been hauled so far from the river also indicated that the burial site just had to be for somebody very important indeed, maybe even a king. Needless to say, the word soon got out and the procession of directors from museums and scholars arrived at the site, all determined to take over from Basil Brown, who was considered an amateur, quite unsuited to be in charge of such an important discovery. However, Mrs. Pretty stood firm, and she agreed that they could catalogue the finds and organise more people to help with the dig, but Basil was to stay in overall charge. The threat of World War II was looming at the time, so it was necessary to speed up the work after all. This involved some serious posturing on both sides, but in the end, Mrs. Pretty got her way. And then, as if it wasn't enough that the discovery of a longship in itself was such a find, the first piece of jewellery emerged from the acid soil, gleaming in the sunlight, untouched from where it had lain for 1,400 years, and as fine a condition as the day it was laid there. One by one, pieces of jewellery, buckles, brooches, rings, and sword handles all emerged from the acid soil, finally leading to the treasure chest itself, with a glittering hoard of gold, silver, garnet-encrusted buckles, and a cache of gold coins. And now we've got to the really exciting part of the treasure itself. I think it's worth lingering over some of these images to explain more fully about them. Just enjoy the intricate work on this shoulder clasp. And now the intricate work on a leather buckle, the leather of course having long since decayed away over the centuries. Here is the purse which contains 7 shillings in gold coins, enough apparently to pay the oarsman for his trip into the afterworld. The detail on bone depicts humans being eaten by wolves. Here we see the wonderful embellishments applied to silver platters. One of the most magnificent finds unearthed is the great double-edged sword, largely intact. Only people of very high status or nobility had double-edged swords. Seen here are 2 bracelets with gold pins. Now we see the whetstone, a sort of symbol of authority similar to a mace, 4-sided and thought to date around 600 AD. And now we see the Lycurgus cup, which is 4th century and made from dichroic glass, which shows different colours when light is passed through it. More embellishments here for leather belts with serpent and crocodile motifs. And in greater detail, here on a shoulder clasp, we see the entwined serpents, which figure greatly in Celtic design. And now a short sequence of the centerpieces of the great shields used in battle. Necklaces with beads in gold, and yet more gold coins. But perhaps the greatest find of all at Sutton Hoo, making parallels with the gold mask of Tutankhamun, is the king's mask or helmet. Whereas the mask of King Tutankhamun was complete, the Sutton Hoo mask was in a myriad pieces, smashed when the triangular roof of wood made over the king's body collapsed over the centuries. However, it has now been meticulously reconstructed so we can see it in all its splendour. So who was it at the end of our story who was buried here in his ship under the Great Mound? Certainly, if it hadn't been for Edith Pretty, the Dark Ages of British history may have remained dark for so much longer, as so little was known of the period. The very fine detailed jewellery and the embellishments have shed a whole new light on the subject, and we can now see just how advanced people were to what had been previously thought possible. The magnificent helmet and treasure found here certainly establish it was a warrior of great stature, and most likely it was King Redwald himself. Perhaps one day another excavation elsewhere will shed more light on the subject. And as the sun sets and we leave this small field in Suffolk, even now to this day we are still left with the mystery of who was the owner of that ship and the treasure of Sutton Hoo.